Hi, I'm Pete, and welcome to Just a Few Acres Farm. Today we're going to spend some time with the Dexters, and I'm going to use that time to talk about how we're grazing our cattle at this, the hottest and slowest growing forage months of the year, and also how many acres we graze, how we graze it, and how we balance our nutrient bank on the farm. That is, how we are able to keep grazing and making hay without importing hay and without fertilizing the ground with chemical fertilizers. So stay tuned. We move our cattle to fresh grass every day, and we move them off of the grass that they were on the previous day. This paddock that we're in now, we moved them to about an hour ago, and it is between a third and a half of an acre. We have a front fence that we move every day, and we have a back fence that we move every day. The back fence takes them off the ground they were on the day before. Connected to the back fence is a laneway fence, which gets extended every day. And so we started at the far end when we start grazing the field, and then every day we just bring it along with the back fence. It takes Hillary and I about 20 minutes to do the move every day. It's a pretty short thing because we've got our rolls down. The reason that the already grazed portions of the field look brown is thatch. That's dead trample from previous grazings, and the grass has been grazed down to about 3 inches, which is how deep the thatch is. That thatch both insulates the soil and provides food for the soil as it gets worked down in. And that's what you see in the upper field as well. The brownness is thatch. The difference between this field and the lower field where they're grazing now is that I didn't go through and clip the dead seed heads after the cattle came through here, so we've got more standing still. This is the furthest point in our grazing system. We're on the last paddock, and then we'll be moving back up into this field. So the cows have to walk back up the laneway here to get to water, mineral, and shade. Right now our pastures are dominated by legumes, mainly alfalfa. There is some clover, but the alfalfa every year takes off in this hot, dry period and outcompetes the grass because alfalfa is so deep-rooted. I love grazing cows on alfalfa. I have read that the crowns are more susceptible to damage from cattle walking on them, but we've had this in for 7 years and it is thriving. And it's great to feed it to them. With so many legumes in our pastures, I've had YouTube viewers ask, well, do you have any problems with bloat from grazing all these legumes? And the answer is no. We've never had a problem with bloat. We're grazing 35 head on about 15 acres this year, and we started out in the spring when the grass growth was heavier with a 45-day, 15-acre pasture rotation in smaller paddocks. Now that the weather is hot and the grass has slowed down, we're grazing on a 30-day rotation, and we're grazing a third to a half an acre per day. This is the third rotation on this field this year. We have another 15 acres that's dedicated to hay. Plus, we cut some of the grazing fields when the grass gets ahead of us in this late spring. And as I said, we're grazing 35 head, and that 35 head consists of 12 brood cows, 2 breeding bulls, 2 steers that are almost ready to go to the butcher, 9 yearlings, and 10 calves. So if you put the numbers together, we're carrying 35 animals, and we're feeding them on 30 acres of land, which is both pasture and hay ground. And we're doing that without buying in any hay or buying commercial fertilizer to fertilize our fields. And this is how we do it. First of all, we're doing it by raising Dexters, which are smaller than typical cattle breeds, and they're also very thrifty on forage. Secondly, we're keeping the forage in its optimal growth stage. We're not letting it get too tall and sit in the field. We're keeping it and its optimal growth stage, which is between about 8 inches and the time when it starts to send seed heads up. We find that we get a lot more total volume of forage harvesting it this way versus stockpiling it. Thirdly, we rotate our rotation to keep our hay fields in better condition than just dedicated hay fields that would be exhausted sooner or later. So we're grazing 3 fields of about 5 acres each this year, and then we're making hay off of another 3 fields. Next year we'll rotate in one of the hay fields and make that grazing ground, rotate one of the grazing fields out and make that hay ground. That way we're getting that benefit of trampled grass, in place manure drops and urine drops in that pasture instead of just taking and taking from it without adding nutrients back. To further add back to the nutrient bank, we're also composting for 1 year and spreading our winter better bedding packs, which consist of the cattle manure along with grain-fed pig manure and chicken manure. Now, grain is the one way that nutrients come onto our farm from outside. We buy in about 20 tons of grain each year, and a good part of that winds up being spread as manure on the fields. You know, I talk to other farmers and they always say, well, you have to fertilize your hay fields after your first cut. And I've never had a problem with not doing that, given the way that we're applying composted manure, doing our grazing, and rotating our hay fields. If you can think of it this way, if a cow grazes a field, most of what they graze winds up in their manure. They're far from perfect digestive animals. So, in a sense, we're picking up forage, running it through the cows, and really dropping it back on the pasture. That manure is further enhanced by the mineral they eat, of which a good part of that mineral passes through them. So that adds to the mineral bank of our fields in a completely natural way without having to have the fertilizer truck come. Coming to grips with this way of thinking all depends on knowing how plant growth and soil health works. Plants just need sunlight, rain, and minerals to grow. Now the sunlight and rain is coming. That's always being added to our farm. The minerals are getting cycled up by the deeper rooted plants like alfalfa and coming into our soil cycle that way to help counterbalance any trace minerals that are leaving via the beef that we sell from our farm. And the poundage of beef is not a lot compared to 30 acres of soil cycling up new nutrients. The third way that trace minerals are coming back into our soil is via the loose mineral that we feed to the cattle. And we feed probably 400 to 500 pounds of that per year, free choice. It includes salt, as well as the macro nutrients, phosphorus and calcium, and the micronutrients, all of those ones that cows need in very small amounts, like selenium, to stay healthy. Most of that mineral is running through the cattle. They eat it, it passes through their system, they drop it on the pasture, it's being added to our farm's nutrient bank as well. And as far as nitrogen goes, because after all, that's the nutrient that everybody thinks of, spraying nitrogen on fields, I run into farmers who plant grass crops and they're just grass. We plant about 40% legumes in our pasture, and that's our principal nitrogen source. Those legumes are continually fixing nitrogen from the air and putting it into the ground and helping to feed all the other grasses, keeping our pastures a nice green color and ensuring more rapid grass growth. Now there is one macro mineral that helps our soil greatly that I can't produce enough of here on the farm, and we do buy that in, and that's lime. Our soil tends to run acid, and we like to bring it up to a close to neutral pH, and the legumes really thrive when that happens. We spend about $1,500 every 5 years putting about a ton of lime per acre on our pastures and hay fields, and the difference is amazing. The weed growth is held down when that happens, when you raise the soil pH up, and the grass just explodes because the lime allows some of the locked nitrogen in the soil, which is inaccessible to plants in an acid soil environment, to be freed up. And then the plants can access that nitrogen, and we see a real bloom about 6 months to a year after that lime is applied. So our farm's a closed system with respect to hay production, and it functions just fine that way, keeping consistent hay yields except for exceptionally dry years like we've had this year. I am worried over time that the phosphorus in our soils will get depleted from hay production. And this year is a year when we're going to do soil tests. We do them every few years. And I'm going to be particularly looking at pH and phosphorus content. I'm going to spend the rest of this video giving you an update on our cows and taking a look at them all, which is something I used to do in videos a lot with our Dexters, and I haven't lately. The first one, of course, is Sammy. Sammy's our bottle-fed calf who won't leave me alone when I'm in the pasture. And a little update on Sammy, he's doing great. He's as friendly as ever. His date at the butcher is in November, and I will be very sad to see him go, but that's part of the cycle on the farm. This is part of our calf clan. Calves hang together, and they tend to get in trouble together too. They'll go on the other side of the grazing fence and mom will yell and yell, and the calves don't really care. Or they'll hang out inside the bale feeder when it's empty. Mom stand outside, yell and yell. Calves don't really care. We got some good looking calves this year, I think. We have two heifers that were bred late last year, and they're getting ready to give birth any day now. This is one of them. This is Daffodil. Her udder's filling up. She's got a big rear end, so we keep a daily watch on her. Look how nice the cattle's coats are this time of year. They're not going through any seasonal shedding. And we feed kelp, and it's said that kelp helps cattle coats a lot. It's filled with all kinds of trace nutrients. And I guess I've seen that since we started feeding kelp. I love the way that their coats look this time of year. One of the ways I can always tell yearling steers from heifers in the field is how their ears hang. Our steers' ears always hang low and a kind of droop from their head. This is Patty, our boss cow. And Patty is round. It seems like, and Patty's the fourth boss cow that we've had in 7 years of grazing, that every boss cow gets fat after she takes charge. I guess she gets the pick of the feed. Nursing on the go. So what's coming next for the cattle? Well, in less than a month, we're going to do our annual sorting. We're going to sort our cull heifers and put them into the heifer yard to finish out for butcher next year. And we'll divide the rest of the herd into two, one to each bull, and we'll enter breeding season that way. I'll be sure to bring you along when we do that. It's a big event here on the farm. I really enjoy hanging with the Dexters. I don't have as much time as I would like to do that. I'm always busy with a lot of other things, so I appreciate the opportunity to spend some time with them and make a video for you all. I hope this was enjoyable, and I'll see you next time.